Hi, Daniel.
Hello. We'll give one more minute and then we'll get started. Good afternoon, good evening. The pause in the music thought it was my cue. Guess I was wrong. Good afternoon, good evening. Welcome to the story behind Cinco de Mayo, as well as a Food Network presentation coming to you live from Ventura County. We are very happy to have all of you here. I know that more will trickle in as we start presentation. Just to give you a little bit of an agenda, the first hour will be on the history of Cinco de Mayo, but I'll let Jay introduce our speaker. That will be the first hour. And then the second hour will be a combination of us having two different restaurants sharing how to make different dishes and drinks. And then after that, we're requesting that you stay on for us to stop the recording and do a toast together. So at that time, we'll ask you all, whoever would like to turn on your video. And I would like to toast, not just for this event, but also a toast to where we're at being 1 year, being virtual and being successful in our Ali program. So I want to do a quick toast together while I have everyone. With that being said, I'm going to turn it over to Jay Evans to introduce our speaker and guest lecture today. Thank you.
Thank you, Daniel. And welcome to all of our OLLI members and friends. I'm Jay Evans. I'm the president of the Volunteer Advisory Council for the OLLI program. And it's my pleasure to welcome you to our Cinco de Mayo event. And as Daniel has just described, we will have a presentation on the story behind Cinco de Mayo, and then the food part of our presentation. It's my pleasure to introduce Stephen Clark, who is the interim program chair and professor of Spanish at CSU Channel Islands, and has been a frequent presenter in the OLLI program. And we've always enjoyed his presentations. And I'm sure that we're all going to learn and enjoy learning more about the story behind Cinco de Mayo. Professor Clark.
Thank you very much, Jay, for that kind introduction. And I'm really happy to be back here with OLLI. Thanks to the board for inviting me to give this talk. I really enjoy every time I get to present to OLLI, and I always learn new things preparing for my presentations, and that hasn't been the exception this time. So I've found some things that I think you'll be really interested to learn about Cinco de Mayo, and hopefully I'll get you geared up for the second part, which I think we're going to learn some good recipes for Cinco de Mayo. So I wanted to start out with a quote by perhaps one of the preeminent experts on Cinco de Mayo in the entire world, by the name of David Hayes Bautista, who is a faculty member at the UCLA School of Medicine, School of Public Health, and he's a sociologist, and he has written a book, perhaps the book, about Cinco de Mayo. And he starts out saying the following: why is the Cinco de Mayo so widely celebrated across the United States when it is scarcely celebrated in Mexico? If the Cinco de Mayo were primarily a Mexican holiday, then the US version ought to be but a pale imitation of the Mexican original. Yet it is the other way around. The answer is found during the Gold Rush and the American Civil War. The answer is actually found in the United States. For the Cinco de Mayo is not a Mexican holiday at all, but rather an American one, created by Latinos in California in the middle of the 19th century. So that's the general idea that I'm going to be focusing on in this talk, that Cinco de Mayo is much more of an American celebration than a Mexican celebration. And how did it become so important to the Latin Hispanic community of the United States? This is the book I was referencing if you're interested. El Cinco de Mayo, an American Tradition by David Hayes Bautista. So before we get to talk about the Cinco de Mayo in more detail, you've probably all been asked the question or heard the question being asked, what is Cinco de Mayo celebrating? And so you probably have heard the answer that it's not celebrating Mexican Independence Day. So let's first look at a couple of the other major Mexican civic historic holidays and see how they're celebrated to compare with how Cinco de Mayo is celebrated in Mexico, just as an introduction. So the most important holiday by far in Mexico in terms of historic civic political commemoration would be the Independence Day, El Día de Independencia, which is celebrated mainly on the eve of September 15th, but all day on the 16th. But the evening celebration on September 15th is the big celebration. That's when they do a really elaborate reenactment of the cry for independence, El Grito de Independencia. In 1810, the independence movement started officially that day and didn't really conclude until about 11 years later. And that's the major holiday that you may have seen scenes from if you're ever watching Spanish language TV on September 15th in the evening. About 1 million people gather on the main square in Mexico City, the Zócalo, and that's in front of the cathedral and the National Palace. And of course, last year it was totally empty, but during the following day, they have a ceremony as well. But this is the main ceremony I wanted to show you because it's very elaborate, a lot of pomp and circumstance. This is the main yearly celebration of independence in Mexico. The president walks out onto the balcony of the National Palace, holding the Mexican flag, ringing the bell, and after he makes some proclamations, there are fireworks, but there's a lot of ritual and a lot of color and a lot of tradition in this ceremony on September 15th. This was last year. It says here, anniversary of the cry of independence in social distance. So usually there's about 1 million people there and there was basically no one last September. And this is a little bit before the evening ceremonies. And this is the ceremony that takes place every evening on September 15th.
Viva José María Moreno! Viva Josefa Ortiz de Domínguez! Viva Ignacio Allende!
So that was the last Independence Day before the pandemic in Mexico. Now, the next day I want to touch on just a minute or two. We're showing what Cinco de Mayo is not. It's not Mexican Independence Day, and it's also not this day. This is the second most important political, historical holiday in Mexico, national holiday. And these two young ladies are my nieces. They're now in college. This was probably about 15 years ago or so. And these are their older sisters who are now in their 30s, but they're not dressed up for Cinco de Mayo and they're not dressed up for Independence Day. They're dressed up for November 20th, which is the celebration of the Mexican Revolution. And typical on this day, the children dress up as if they were revolutionary soldiers, both male and female revolutionary soldiers, and they have parades throughout the entire country. This is a day that celebrates the start of the revolution in 1910 against a 30-year dictatorship in Mexico. And there's a lot of ceremonies in Mexico City, but basically every city of some size, even small towns, have celebrations and parades. This day is known for parades, traditionally parades, school parades, all sorts of parades. This is a parade in Mexico City right in front of the monument to the revolution. So we're talking about the revolution of 1910, which was basically a 10-year, eventually became a civil war, basically known for the charismatic, iconic figures of Pancho Villa and Emiliano Zapata, revolting against the dictatorship of Porfirio Diaz. And that was basically a 30-year-long dictatorship. Here's a famous mural of Porfirio Diaz in the Castillo de Chapultepec in Mexico City. You can see he has his foot firmly planted on the constitution of the country. The revolution had a couple of different mottos. It started as a political movement, trying to get free elections and a democratic system. This was the first motto of the revolution: effective suffrage, no re-election. And ever since then, Mexico has had no re-election for president since the Mexican Revolution. But later it became more of a social justice movement. It started as a political movement, but later became a social justice movement, sort of change in the objectives after the main cause of the revolution was not people not being able to vote, but people seeing the great contrast between the haves. Here we have a scene from a racetrack in 1910 in one of the upper class neighborhoods of Mexico City, between the haves and the have-nots, which much outnumbered the haves as always. So that's the second most important celebration in Mexico. Yes.
Are we supposed to be seeing images as you're talking? Because I'm not seeing anything about the celebration in Mexico City or anything else.
Because my screen says you are screen sharing at the top.
Yeah, we're seeing it here. I'm seeing it.
Yes, I can see it.
Well, where should I be then?
I can see it.
Where should I be?
Well, he should have shared his screen.
I don't know what.
Let's do the following. I'm going to stop sharing for a minute, and then I'm going to restart the share, and we'll see if that helps, okay? So now I'm going to restart the screen share. Are we seeing my screen again?
Yes, we're seeing it.
Federal holidays.
So I don't know who could not see it, but...
We're good. Okay. We're good, thank you.
Okay, great. So... let's take a look and just see how this compares. The federal holidays in the US and Mexico, it surprised me. In the United States, we have basically 10 federal holidays. And there's the list right there. We pretty much know the dates or the approximate dates of those. Mexico actually has about 40% fewer official federal obligatory holidays holidays, which are the following: New Year's, the day of the Constitution, which is February 5th, the birthday of Benito Juarez, which is March 21st. We're going to talk a little bit more about him. You can think of him as the Abraham Lincoln of Mexico to a certain extent. Labor Day, which in Mexico is called the Day of Work, Día del Trabajo, which is May 1st. Independence Day, which is, as we just saw, September 15th, it starts the celebration. September 16th is the actual day. Day of the Revolution, which we just saw some scenes of, November 20th. And then Christmas. Those are the only federally mandated holidays in Mexico. And you'll notice that on that short list, Cinco de Mayo is nowhere to be found. Now, if you look at the actual days that students do not have to go to class in Mexico, you'll see more days than the actual federal holidays. But if you notice the ones that are called Día Festivo, those are the ones that I just pointed out. That's the day of the Constitution. Some of these are in-service teacher days. Then we have another one here, Día Festivo, Benito Juarez's birthday. Then we have here, Día Festivo for Independence Day. Then we have the Day of the Dead, which is not an official government holiday. Then we have the Revolution Day, Día de la Revolución, November 20th. And then we have May 5th, which is not celebrated as Cinco de Mayo, but the anniversary of the Battle of Puebla. It's really not a celebration in most of Mexico, other than in the city where that battle took place, which we'll talk about in a minute. But what I wanted to show you that is that it actually is on the school calendars in Mexico as a day without classes, but it's a very minor, almost forgotten holiday in most of Mexico, maybe somewhat similar to a minor federal holiday in the US. I was trying to think of an approximation, maybe President's Day, when we don't usually see big celebrations, but a lot of times there's no school that day. So if we look at the history of Mexico, try to see where Cinco de Mayo fits into Mexico's history, we can probably point out maybe five major events that have shaped Mexico's history, starting with the Spanish conquest in 1519, and then independence 300 years later. Basically, Mexico is a colony of Spain for 300 years. Then the Mexican-American War, which has a different name in Mexico, and we'll talk about that in a second. Then what's called the Reform and the French Intervention, and finally the Mexican Revolution, which we just touched on briefly. So today, what I want to go in a little bit more in depth is these two major events in Mexican history. What we call a Mexican-American War, in Mexico, it has a very different name, the United States Intervention, and the Reform, a series of laws created by Benito Juarez to try to make Mexico a more just country, and the French Intervention. We're going to go into basically the mid-1800s to see what was happening in Mexico and what was happening in the US, getting back to David Hayes' emphasis on how this holiday really was born in the US, but related to what was happening in Mexico, but perhaps even more so what was happening in the US at the time. So let's jump into the mid-1800s. The Mexican-American War is how this conflict is referred to in the encyclopedias in English. But if we look at Wikipedia in Spanish, you don't see that term. You see Intervención Estadounidense en México, the United States Intervention in Mexico. The official government page, Secretary for National Defense, they even use a more dramatic term, the North American Invasion. There's actually a museum in Mexico City, which I hope I can talk a little bit more about this summer, called the National Museum of Interventions, which focuses a lot on the other countries that have intervened in Mexico's history. Mexico in France being among the most prominent. So the Mexican-American War, this is one of the first major build-up events to the Cinco de Mayo. So just a sort of a little fly-by, bird's-eye view of the Mexican-American War briefly. No? So we're in the mid-1840s. James Polk becomes president, and he's very much enamored of the idea of manifest destiny, of the vision that the U.S. was divinely permitted to expand from coast to coast to fulfill their divine destiny. And they wanted to basically purchase the land that then belonged to Mexico, an offer that was rebuffed. And Polk was not one to just take that as the final word in the matter. And so the disputed lands just over the Rio Grande, in Mexico it's called the Rio Bravo, the Rio Grande, they were invaded by the U.S. to sort of provoke Mexico into a conflict. Mexico obviously responded to that provocation. They claimed those disputed lands as well. They killed some U.S. soldiers. The U.S. Congress declared war, but Mexico never did so. The war was not much of a contest, and it ended very quickly. And Mexico was basically forced to sell their northern territories for $15 million and to assume damage claims. So what did Mexico lose at the signing of the treaty ending the Mexican-American War in 1848? They lost basically half of their territory. The states that we call now California, Nevada, Utah, Colorado, notice that a lot of them have Spanish names, Arizona, the arid zone, Nuevo Mexico, and part of Wyoming. So that's the first event to keep in mind as we dive deeper into Cinco de Mayo. The second series of events started in the next decade, around the mid-1850s, when a very admired, perhaps the most admired president in the history of Mexico, you might call him the Abraham Lincoln of Mexico, Benito Juarez. Actually, it's kind of ironic that one of Europe's most reviled dictators, Benito Mussolini, his parents named him after this beloved, peace-loving, almost a saintly figure in Mexico. One of his famous quotes was, "El respeto del derecho ajeno es la paz," which means respecting the rights of others is the truest definition of peace. No? He is the namesake of Benito Mussolini, of all people. No? So this reform and French intervention, the protagonists of this, basically a civil war in Mexico, were Benito Juarez, General Santa Anna, who had lost the Mexican-American War or the North American invasion of Mexico, and the French emperor at the time, the last French monarch, Maximilian III, nephew of Napoleon Bonaparte, and sort of the puppet emperor that he placed on the crown of Mexico to sort of reassert French power in the New World about the middle of the 1800s. So to give us a sort of a backdrop into what's going on in Mexico at this time, I have just a few minutes by Carlos Fuentes, Mexico's probably greatest novelist of all time, and passed away about 9 years ago. In May of 2012, and he has a series of documentaries on Latin America. He focuses very briefly on this episode in Mexican history as sort of a symbol of what was happening in Latin America at this time. The nations were independent, but the independence movements did not resolve the festering problems of the countries. And I'll let him take it from here.
And in this lay the tragic irony of Spanish America. The land was there, the bounty, the promise of independence. What was not there was the experience of democracy. Unable to put their houses in order, one country after another swung endlessly between anarchy and tyranny.
Sometimes murals by the Mexican artist Diego Rivera can look suspiciously like comic strips, something which perfectly suits the prototypical Latin American comic opera tyrant, the Mexican general Santa Anna, who was 11 times president of Mexico between independence and the middle of the 19th century, and was capable of staging coups against himself. He lost a leg in a battle and had it buried with great pomp and splendor and blessed by the Archbishop in the National Cathedral. When he fell from power, the populace unburied the leg and dragged it through the streets of Mexico City. When he came back to power, he once more buried the leg with all pomp and splendor and so on. But he lost something more than his leg. In 1848, the United States waged an unjust war against Mexico in the name of manifest destiny. And Santana lost fully one half of the national territory of Mexico, all of our northern provinces from Texas to California. There was nothing funny about this, and the event left a profound wound in the Mexican national soul. But when Santa Anna rewarded himself by naming himself Most Serene Highness, the nation revolted against him, led by the Liberal Party, one of whose most prominent members was a lawyer called Benito Juarez.
Now, for the first time in our independent history, a full-blooded Indian became president of the Republic. At the age of 12, he was like any other of the illiterate shepherd boys who can still be found tending the family animals in the hills above the town of Oaxaca in southern Mexico. There he might have spent his days, but through the influence of his sister, who was working in the city, he was taken into the house of a Franciscan priest who taught him to read and write in Spanish. This good father nurtured the hope that the young boy, who would one day be known as the scourge of the Catholic Church, might study for the priesthood. Instead, he became a lawyer.
March 21st has become a national holiday in Mexico. It is the date of the birth of Benito Juarez. Now, I recall that when I was 17 years old, I was studying at a Catholic prep school in Mexico City, and the priests did not celebrate March 21st because they considered Juarez to be some kind of villain of Mexican history. So many of the students, many of my school chums and I banded together so as to strike to celebrate March 21st and thus honor Benito Juarez and what he stood for. We were threatened with expulsion from the school, but finally we were not. And I think the reason is that we were right.
Time makes legends out of popular heroes. But why was the presidency of Benito Juarez so vital to the future of Mexico, and indeed to the whole of Spanish America?
Well, to begin with, I think that no one tried more seriously to make the dreams of Simón Bolívar and San Martín become true. Strong institutions, not strong men. Civilian government, not military rule. No one above the rule of law. The creation of a modern secular state. To obtain all of this, Benito Juarez separated church from state. He nationalized the idle wealth accumulated by the church during the colonial years and set it into economic circulation. He abolished the privileges of the aristocracy and the army. What did he get in response? A double whammy. First, the conservatives in opposition to Juarez's laws plunged the country into 3 years of civil war. And when they were defeated in battle by Juarez, they searched for support abroad and found it in France, where Napoleon III dreamt of creating a French empire in the Americas. The French and the Mexican conservatives put the crown of Mexico on the head Austrian Prince Maximilian of Habsburg, a descendant of Charles V and Philip II. It was a phantom crown.
After a bumpy ride from the coast, Maximilian and his Belgian wife, the Empress Carlota, were installed in Chapultepec Castle in the heart of Mexico City. From the grand staterooms, Maximilian tried to assert his independence. In spite of howls of protest from Rome, he attempted to uphold the confiscation of church property decreed by Juarez. But in reality, he was not independent. He was a puppet backed by the bayonets of the French army. When he was prevailed upon to sign the so-called Black Decree, condemning to instant execution any Mexican found bearing arms, he condemned himself to death. Carlota's fate would be almost as bleak. She was destined to lose both her husband and her wits. But the people were not impressed. They had glimpsed a land of a different kind, offered by a man who was one of them, a land of freedom and self-determination. With massive public support, Juarez raised a volunteer army to challenge this royalist regime imposed from overseas. In this carriage, President Juarez traveled across the deserts of northern Mexico, loaded with archives, unbending, uncompromising, but perhaps hurt and amazed that the European civilization he had come to admire so much and hope to emulate had turned her back on him, denying Mexico the right to rule herself. For from this government on wheels, Benito Juarez was defending the independence of all of Latin America. The resistance of his guerrillas forced the French to abandon Maximilian. Leading a small group of loyalists, the emperor surrendered after the siege of Querétaro. Unbending to the last, Juarez refused clemency to Maximilian. This old photograph shows the execution of this bewildered man. He had decreed the death of thousands of Mexican patriots. Now he faced his own.
So that gives you a little overview of the French intervention in Mexico during and after what was called the Reform Wars, where Benito Juarez was trying to make Mexico a more modern state, separate church from state. And there's a main boulevard in Mexico City that I'll talk more about this summer called Paseo de la Reforma. You may have heard of that. That's like one of the main, sort of the Mexican Champs-Élysées. And that's the name that it was given after the French had left Mexico. But it was basically built to transport Carlota and Maximilian from their castle in Chapultepec Park to the National Palace. And so it was originally called Paseo de la Carlota, Charlotte's passway or boulevard, you could say. So this is when it was just being built there during the time of the French. La Reforma, this reform instituted by Benito Juarez, which sparked the ire of the wealthy and the church and the military. Now it's also the name of one of Mexico's leading newspapers, The Reform, no? So while that was happening in Mexico, the initial stages of Benito Juarez reform, California and the US was undergoing the largest mass migration in our history. And if you look at the population in California before the gold rush, very few Anglo-Americans, very few relatively formerly Mexicans, but not after the statehood, obviously, very few Californios, the Mexican residents of California, and many Native Americans. After the gold rush, by the mid-1850s, about 300,000 new arrivals were in California, and the Californios, who were formerly Mexican citizens, woke up one day and were no longer Mexican they sort of became strangers in their own land as California became the 31st state in 1850. So what did this mean in the new California? And this, I think, gets to the heart of the birth of the Cinco de Mayo and its meaning in the US. The new California, the post-Mexico California, Anglo culture becomes more and more dominant. Hispanic culture becomes more and more marginalized. And part of this marginalization was on purpose through property taxes and foreign miners taxes and legal tricks to try to get as many parcels of land out of the hands of the Hispanics as possible. And some laws were passed, which are even hard to believe existed at some point, with names such as the Greaser Act, which was the official name of this law passed in 1855. The Greaser Act in California was passed to punish vagrants, vagabonds, dangerous and suspicious persons, aimed mainly at people who are, quote, commonly known as greasers or the issue of Spanish and Indian blood, and who go armed and are not peaceable and quiet persons. In section 3 of this act, it says that the justice of the peace shall apprehend such persons, and they may be sentenced to the county jail for additional time as the court may deem proper. So in this environment of increasing marginalization, increasing dominance of by the Anglo culture, increasing marginalization of the Hispanic culture, I wanted to give you an example in one person's experience of what was going on in California during this time. And I wanted to share this map of all the 23 campuses of the Cal State system to give you an idea of what I mean by increased marginalization, strangers in their own land, a conquered enemy sentiment among the Hispanic community in California, which was small but growing with the immigration due to the gold rush. If you look at all these campuses of the Cal State University system, you may notice one name sticks out, perhaps because it's not one of the largest or most well-known campuses of the system. Cal State Dominguez Hills in southern Los Angeles. The campus is named after Manuel Dominguez, who was a very prominent Californian, California, and then US citizen, very prominent mayor of Los Angeles, LA County supervisor, founder of cities such as San Pedro and I believe Compton as well, and actually a signatory of the California Constitution. So we're talking about one of the pillars of California society prior to its incorporation as a state. Now, he was called to San Francisco to testify in a trial in 1857. And he got there and he was informed by the judge that he was not able to testify. His testimony would not be accepted in this trial because he had Hispanic and indigenous blood. And this controversy, which erupted, is known as the first major racial, well-publicized racial conflict in California, that's got a lot of coverage in the media, specifically the Spanish language media. A lot of Spanish language newspapers at the time. And then the editor of one of the papers at the time wrote a defense of Manuel Dominguez, saying how honorable he was, the important positions that he had held. And he concludes his remarks by saying, "We think that if it were possible to perform a chemical analysis of our brethren from the United States, there would be very few persons who would emerge as not having at least a drop of Indian or Black blood. The age of blue bloods, if it ever existed, is assuredly not present. This was in response to the humiliation suffered by one of the leading lights of California society, Manuel Dominguez, signer of the Constitution. You can see the Constitution here in Spanish. California's original laws required, original Constitution required all laws to be published in English and Spanish. There you can see his name on the Constitution. So in this environment of increased hostility and marginalization, the Hispanic community was sort of rallying together to preserve their identity, preserve what united them, which was the language, the newspapers, even the laws were published in Spanish, although that was reversed in an 1872 amendment to the Constitution of California. The religion obviously held a played an important role in uniting the Latino groups, not only the Mexican and Mexican descendants, but the recent arrivals from other parts of Latin America during the Gold Rush, the church festivities, the church groups, the rituals, the cultural ties that they all shared, specific stores and restaurants and hotels and transportation services and civic organizations that catered to these, this group of Hispanics that were, they're trying to find their place in this new Anglo-dominated California. Here are a few of the newspapers that were popular at the time: El Amigo del Pueblo in Los Angeles, The Friend of the People; La Voz de México, The Voice of Mexico in San Francisco; El Nuevo Mundo in San Francisco; La Voz de Chile, geared towards a significant number of Chilean immigrants. I don't know if you're familiar with Isabel Allende, but she has a novel about a Chilean immigrant to California during the Gold Rush. So these are some examples of the cultural factors that maintain the Hispanic community united, help them find their place in this new Anglo reality amongst a mix of Hispanics. Along with the existing residents, there began to emerge many more familial ties, and these immigrants from the Gold Rush were no longer visitors, they were setting down roots. And so we see the first generation of US-born Hispanics. They're now US-born, bilingual, bicultural, sort of trying to find their place as Latinos in Anglo-dominated America. Meanwhile, back in Mexico, Benito Juarez suspends the debt payments. Mexico was greatly in debt over that reform war, and Mexico decided to suspend those payments to French, Spanish, and English banks. Mexico was able to reach an agreement with the Spanish and the English banks, but France decided to occupy. And that occupation was happening precisely at the time the US was going through its most tragic and existential circumstances of the Civil War. So a lot of connections between Mexico and the US at this time. Both nations are basically fighting to survive. We're in the early 1860s. Napoleon III sees an opportune moment to invade Mexico. US was obviously more than occupied with the Civil War. And the newspapers, the Spanish language newspapers in California are adamant in their support for both Benito Juarez and the cause of the Union, which are perceived to be common causes in preserving a society not dominated by tyranny, not dominated by slavery, dominated by the rule of law, dominated by a modern liberal secular state. And so what happened on May 5th, while the French were starting to gain a foothold in Mexico during that invasion to theoretically recover their debts, but also to reestablish their dominance in the New World. The first main battle of the French intervention in Mexico took place on May 5th in 1862. And the French were defeated by a ragtag band of Mexican soldiers loyal to the cause of Benito Juarez and his defense of a modern secular Mexican state. The French send in reinforcements. They are able to gain support from the collaborators of Mexico's conservative groups and the upper class in Mexico. Unfortunately, that victory by the forces of Benito Juarez was not the definitive victory, and the French retook the city of Puebla about a year later after a two-month siege. But it really made a strong impact in California. When news of the Battle of Puebla reached California, weeks later, it made a huge impact on the Mexicans in California. They somehow identified with that victory of the underdog being dominated by a foreign power, because somehow for them it mirrored their situation in what was their country and in the US until it was lost to the US in the Mexican-American War. And donations start to pour in from the Mexican Hispanic community in California to help the cause of Benito Juarez. And so what I have here, and I wanted to share this, I found this very interesting as I was doing my research. The first Cinco de Mayo celebration in the history of Latin America and the Americas in general took place in a small city in Northern California, bigger at the time because of a gold rush town, Columbia, California, in the Sierra Nevada foothills, took place on May 22nd of 1862. This is a letter to the editor of one of these Hispanic newspapers at the time, La Voz de México. And the writer of this letter says, I have the honor of addressing you, meaning the editor of the paper, with the sole objective of informing you of the incomparable joy with which we received the wonderful news of our triumph, against the French, which we have celebrated with a tremendous party and patriotic singing, but in the midst of the greatest decorum and harmony at the same time. And this is about 2 weeks after Cinco de Mayo, the news reaches California. It's received with great joy by the Hispanic community. And I thought it was kind of ironic as I was doing my research. Columbia, California, I had not heard of that city, but one of the largest cities at the time in California. And I thought it was kind of ironic that the name of this city where Cinco de Mayo was first celebrated as a sort of manifestation of pride in the Hispanic community is actually the same name as the District of Columbia. Columbia being an allegory, sort of a female version of Uncle Sam. You probably are familiar with the song Columbia, Gem of the Ocean, which was almost a pseudo-national anthem at the time. And this is the place, Columbia, California, where the Mexican-American, Hispanic-American community first starts to reclaim a Mexican tradition and reclaim their place in California, celebrate their culture, celebrate their strength in the face of an enormous fighting force, which was the French army at the time. So you start to see more newspaper clippings of the retreat of the French, long live Mexican independence. These are more newspaper clippings from Hispanic newspapers in California, celebrating the victory of the French, of the Mexicans over the French in that first battle of Puebla, May 5th, 1862. Why Puebla, Mexico? Why Puebla? Why was it so important to the French and even to the people in California of Mexican heritage celebrating this victory? Well, strategic location, about halfway from the coast to Mexico City, symbolically very important to the Mexican culture. The city of Puebla was renamed Puebla de Zaragoza in honor of the general who defended the city, one of the richest cities in Mexico at the time and even today, one of the most rich, not only economically, but artistically, culturally, architecturally. Some of the biggest industries in Mexico, the auto industry, the largest Volkswagen plant in the world is there today. This is a museum of the Baroque in Mexico. They're famous in Puebla, famous for their Baroque architecture. And Puebla, very important even at the time, because it's the origin, the birthplace, the cradle of some of the most traditional Mexican dishes, such as mole poblano. You may have tried chicken in a mole sauce. Mole is actually an Aztec word, but it became a very popular dish during the colonial times and even from pre-Hispanic times. Chiles en nogada, these dishes have their roots in the city of Puebla. And the chili pepper used to make this dish actually comes from or originates in the Puebla region. It's called the Poblano chili. And some of the most emblematic examples of Mexican art, Mexican handicrafts, Mexican artistic expressions, such as the tiles, the famous tile work, originally from Spain, but very much taken up in Puebla and the Talavera factories in Puebla producing the famous tiles, some of which you can see on our campus here in Channel Islands if you go into some of the older courtyards on the campus. So Puebla was really a symbolic, very important city as an emblem of the perhaps the great richness of Mexican culture. Some of the traditional dress of Mexican women at the time originated there. And these are the costumes you'll see people wearing at the Mexican Cinco de Mayo celebrations. So how did that tradition, that one tradition, get passed down to today from the first Cinco de Mayo? It has to do with civil groups which emerged in this general time period called Juntas Patrióticas, which were civic organizations of California Latinos helping to raise funds for Benito Juárez. Many of them located throughout California, sort of community benevolent organizations trying to provide help and assistance to the Mexican community in Mexican-American community in California, but also to the cause of Benito Juárez against the French in Mexico. You can see some of their publications and calendars and event advertising. This is a 15th and 16th September celebration of the in early 1900s by one of the Juntas Patrióticas in San Diego. And these are basically civic organizations. They provided charity and sort of a social safety net to Hispanic community, civil and legal aid, provided training grounds for future Latino leaders, helped to support the newspapers, even organized boycotts against the French merchants. And so little by little, the Cinco de Mayo becomes institutionalized as sort of a celebration, not only of what's going on in Mexico, but of pride in the Latino community, the Latino heritage of the United States, specifically California, and then later spreading. Now it's spread basically all across the United States. And some of these Juntas Patrióticas, these civic organizations, even sent people to Mexico to fight in the war against the French. Some of the imagery you can even find on Google Images to this day. This is a list of subscribers from that Junta Patriótica civic organization in San Jose. People are contributing this amount each month to the cause of Mexico. And there's about 130, roughly, of these civic organizations keeping the memory of Cinco de Mayo alive and at the same time supporting the cause of the Union in the Civil War. Nowadays, the role played by these Juntas Patrióticas has been taken up by organizations you may be familiar with, such as the National Council of La Raza and political lobbying groups. And according to David Hayes Bautista, the maximum authority on this topic, these modern day organizations, the Mexican American Legal Defense Fund, for example, these are basically the greatest legacy of these organizations, which emerged in the wake of the Battle of Puebla and its celebration in California in the mid 1800s. So I wanted to finish up showing you a few images of Cinco de Mayo in Puebla, Mexico, where it is celebrated in Cinco de Mayo, on Cinco de Mayo. These are images from the city of Puebla, the one place in Mexico where Cinco de Mayo is celebrated with a major parade and festivities and pomp and circumstance. But in the rest of Mexico, it goes largely uncelebrated and largely even unnoticed. These are some pictures of where the largest celebrations of Cinco de Mayo are in the United States today. And you can see that this is actually in St. Paul, Minnesota, which has one of the largest and most elaborate Cinco de Mayo celebrations. These first images are from St. Paul, Minnesota. You see the Minnesota license plate there. But the largest celebration of Cinco de Mayo in all the United States, in all the world, you could say, is in Denver, Colorado, which has about 400,000 people on average attending over 2 days. They have Chihuahua races in addition to folkloric dancing, lowrider car competitions, and parades of people celebrating their Hispanic heritage along the main thoroughfares in Denver. There's the capital of Denver. They have a run also on Cinco de Mayo. San Diego, California. A lot of cities have Cinco de Mayo today. The Cinco de Mayo in Los Angeles seems to have fallen on hard times. Used to be called Fiesta de Broadway, but from what I've read, it's become much smaller in recent years. And you can even see Cinco de Mayo's in places not typically associated with large Hispanic communities. But as we know, more and more Hispanic communities are becoming seen and emerging in areas all over the country. This in Omaha, Nebraska, sponsored by the Consulate of Mexico. They mentioned the Battle of Puebla here, but really what we're celebrating in Cinco de Mayo in the United States is the richness, the vibrancy of the Hispanic community, their contributions to the U.S. throughout our history. And you may be aware that in 1998, I believe, Cinco de Mayo received its own postage stamp, and there was inaugurated in 2001 a tradition in the White House celebrating Cinco de Mayo, which went through 2016, I believe. And obviously it's not being celebrated this year because of the pandemic, but I don't know if anyone noticed this. There was a celebration, at least a lunch, a takeout lunch celebration by President Biden to get some takeout food in Washington, D.C. And here he is in a restaurant not too far from the White House. And he's asked what he's purchased. He responds, tacos and enchiladas, but the following questions did not have anything to do with Cinco de Mayo. So I hope he got to enjoy his tacos and his enchiladas. And I have a lot more to share with you, but I think we're just about out of time. So I wanted to stop here and hope that you enjoyed what I had to share with you. See if I can answer any questions. I know you have a Mexican food presentation coming up, but let me take a pause here and see if we have any time for questions.
I'd like to ask a question. I was unaware of the French presence in Central and South America, empire-wise. I mean, I knew, of course, the Spanish, but it seems to me that was an odd juxtaposition of France into Central or South America.
Yeah, it is not as widely known as you might think, and Latin America in general is considered to be the terrain of the former Spanish and Portuguese colonies, but northern part of South America, French Suriname, and then you have French Guyana, excuse me, and you had the French intervention in Mexico. But yeah, that's a really, really significant event in the history of Mexico, and gave way to the celebration of Cinco de Mayo that we have today. Mm-hmm. Any other questions, comments, observations?
Thank you so much. That was really interesting.
You're very welcome. Mm-hmm.
Are we unmuted?
You are.
That was really interesting. I learned a lot of things about California history I never even knew.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's a lot hidden beneath the surface of Cinco de Mayo that tells a lot about the history of California. I wonder myself how many people know that the California State Constitution was originally written in Spanish and English, and mm-hmm. the laws were required to be published in both languages.
Most interesting.
Thank you for a great presentation, Stephen.
Okay, you're welcome. I wish I could see everyone, but it's a new reality. And maybe one of these days we'll be back in person.
Well, thank you so much, Dr. Stephen Clark. We truly appreciate it. He, just so you guys know, we actually met with Dr. Batista's department, and they were talking about different options to have him present as well, but they were offering us a video, and I wanted a real human being presenting and one of our own faculty. So there's a lot of videos online with Dr. Batista presenting about Cinco de Mayo, so I highly recommend that you look into that. You can Google UCLA and Dr. Batista, and you'll see a whole bunch of videos about him and how he talks about Cinco de Mayo as well in the history. So I do want you to know that we wanted to share that with you. So what we're gonna do now is we're gonna take a 10-minute break. At this time, it's 4:03, so we'll be back at 4:13. So go ahead and take a break. What we're gonna do is we're gonna play two cooking shows from two different restaurants that are locally. Ricky will introduce that to all of us. And then after that, like I said, we're gonna do a toast. And I would like whoever would like to have their video turned on, I would like to do a toast to celebrate Cinco de Mayo, but also really celebrate we went a full year in this virtual land together, and it's because of all of you that we were able to do that. So I wanna celebrate that as well. So again, take a 10-minute break. We're gonna stop the recording for a second and off thank Al, Jay, and Ricky for putting this all together for you all today. They put a lot of work into this, so we appreciate it. With that being said, Ricky, would you like to share about Julio's promotional, and then we'll play the video? Ricky, can you hear me? What we'll do is we'll talk about it after. Let's go ahead and play the video. Michael Trainer, go ahead.
Greetings, everyone. I hope you enjoyed the first portion of our program, The History of Cinco de Mayo, presented by Dr. Clark. For the second portion of our program, we invited two of our favorite restaurants in Ventura County to demonstrate favorite recipes by their patrons. So right now we're at Julio's restaurant, enjoying the food and drink that was prepared by them. If you're interested in replicating any of the recipes today, be sure you have a pen and paper handy so you can copy down those instructions. So enjoy. Cheers.
Welcome to Julio's Agave Grill. Thank you for being here today. We're going to make sure that we're going to send you on a nice culinary delight. We have two of our best dishes and one of our favorite selling margaritas. Our staff is proudly here today, and we really appreciate it, and happy Cinco de Mayo.
Let's start off with one of the signature appetizers at Julio's, their jalapeno poppers. For this recipe, you'll need sliced and hollowed jalapenos, shredded lettuce, chipotle sauce, red onion, cream cheese, freshly chopped cilantro and green onion, bacon bits, and finally, queso fresco to garnish. As you wait for your jalapenos to fry either in a pan with a little bit of oil or in your fryer at home, start off by plating your bed of shredded lettuce on a separate dish and top it off with chipotle sauce and a bit of freshly chopped red onion. Set this plate to the side so you can begin preparing your fried jalapenos. Preheat your oven to 425 degrees and prepare a mix of cream cheese, chopped cilantro, and green onion. Stuff your hollowed jalapenos with this mixture and top it off with bacon bits. Place your now stuffed jalapenos in the oven and bake for about 5 to 10 minutes until the cream cheese mixture starts bubbling. After your stuffed jalapenos are done in the oven, quickly transfer them to the plate of shredded lettuce and top with some queso fresco to taste. Appetizers done. Next, let's move on to the main course, the molcajete. This family-style meal gets its name after the large traditional basalt mortar it's served in, which is known for its excellent heat-retaining properties when used as a serving dish. However, the molcajete can easily be substituted for an oven-safe pan for those without access to one. To make a molcajete dish, you'll need an assortment of meats such as chicken, skirt steak, chorizo or sausage, fajita veggies, including onions and bell peppers, two full green onions, jalapeno, queso fresco, two cactus paddles, and the salsa of your choosing. To begin, preheat your oven to 250 degrees and place your molcajete or oven-safe pan inside to begin warming. Next, cut up your meats, fajita veggies, jalapeno, green onion, and cactus paddles individually into long strips and fry each ingredient separately until your veggies are browned and your meats are cooked thoroughly. After everything is cooked, pull the hot molcajete out of the oven and begin layering in your ingredients. Start off with a bed of fajita veggies and layer on your prepared meats. Line the molcajete with fried cactus paddles and green onion, and finish off by topping the entire dish with a sliced queso fresco and a generous amount of salsa. Finally, it wouldn't be a celebratory meal without a delicious drink, so let's head over to the bar to learn how to make a moonshine margarita and a cucumber jalapeno margarita.
Hello, welcome to Julio's. My name is Katrina and I am the bartender. I'm gonna be making a moonshine margarita. And this is the glass we typically use. Gonna get some salt on the rim. Some ice. And in the shaker, we are going to get 6 ounces of Patron Silver, 2, 4, and 6. Then we are gonna get 4 ounces of triple sec. There's 2 and 4. And the rest is our sweet and sour mix. And that is what comes in the shaker. And we also get 2 extra little shots, one of the orange liqueur. And our moonshine mezcal, which is a la venenosa. And 1 lime. 1 orange. And a straw. And you can either pour the shots in the shaker if you'd like, or you can add it in after. And there we go, and here's the 2 shots. So we are now gonna make a jalapeno and cucumber margarita. So I put 2 slices of cucumbers and 2 slices of jalapeno, and I'll muddle it into the shaker so you get little pieces in your drink as well. Add some ice 3 ounces of the Patron, 2, 3, and 1.5 of the triple sec. 1.5, and the rest again is a sweet and sour. Some salt for the rim of the cup. Ice. Topped with 1 cucumber and 1 jalapeno. Shake it up. Oh, and a lime. Straw. And pour that in. And the jalapeno and cucumber margarita.
Hello and welcome to Tortillas Grill at Galaxy Jet Islands. Since 2008, we've been open to the public, serving our menu recipes inspired by our mother's cooking. Having grown up and worked on a local farm here in Ventura County, we appreciated everything. We continue to support our local farmers, offering the fruits and vegetables as part of our seasonal menu. Please come and join our outdoor patio, indoor dining, or pull up a bar stool. We have over 60 beverages to choose from. We're open Monday through Saturdays. We are closed on Sundays.
Fajita. Sí, sí. Ah, qué bueno.
gente!
All right, Michael, you can stop sharing the screen. Thank you so much. We were hopeful to have a couple of more dishes to share. Unfortunately, due to how busy one of the restaurants was, we just did not have that. I hope you